All right. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. We got a lot to get to. Happy Mother's Day. If you guys would, as you file in, we got a video for you. And if you would, turn your attentions toward the screens for this video.
I was a resident with Angels Cove. I actually had my twins there. I came to Angels Cove after leaving rehab. I was very nervous to keep the twins, but the facility that I was at said that this was going to be a very good place for me to go. During that time, what was going through my head was to just go the easy way out and have an abortion. I didn't have any family support. I didn't have much help at all. I was homeless. My main goal was just to stay clean and be in a stable environment, and that's exactly what I got coming to Angels Cove. So coming here was the best choice I could have made, and it saved the twins' life ultimately. I was able to get the right support through people that were here teaching classes. Women's Empowerment was one of my favorite classes that we'd sit and do, as well as parenting classes at Grace Haven opened my mind to how can I learn how to be a better parent? How can I learn how to deal with those tough situations that are gonna happen with my children? So I'm in school for social work full time now. I'm also working. I ended up finding my own place. I have a great church family here. I have a great support system. I don't feel hopeless anymore. I feel like there's so much more that I can do now in life. You gotta have the right people that are like, look, you can do it. You're not by yourself, and you can do it. For my kids now moving forward, since I've received all this help and I've been so blessed to gain the stability that I needed in my life, I really feel like my kids have a chance to break so many generational curses, and they have a chance to not be addicts and to understand what a normal functioning family is, and to come home to a bed, a nice warm bed, and just food in the house. Basic things, but the most important thing is love and family.
I would like to ask you to partner with the Baptist Children's Home by supporting the Mother's Day offering to help those who are hurting and grieving.
Well, hopefully you enjoyed that video. Every Mother's Day, we give a special offering to the Baptist Children's Home. And there is this pamphlet in your bulletin today that explains the different facilities we have at Baptist Children's Home. It's more than Carmi. It's the Grace Haven. It's the Crisis Pregnancy Center. It's the Adoption Place. It's there. And on this thing, you can give online, give by your phone. Man, just give an offering. It makes a difference in a kid's life. And today, we're celebrating Mother's Day, and it's appropriate because there's a lot of moms out there that adopted some kids, that just know some kids, that are a mother to them, and we want to honor them today by doing this offering today. So please prayerfully consider giving to the Baptist Children's Home, and this thing's in there, and make a difference, okay? Even if it's $20, it'll make a difference. Give it in the Lord's name, okay? But do that, and man, we'll honor our moms today. We do have another video right here. Let's go with our mom's video.
Come on, sweetie. Oh, honey, you've got something on your face.
Mom.
Did you brush your teeth? Did you really brush your teeth? Let me smell your breath.
Mom!
Okay, Jake, honey, this is the only thing I can find, all right?
Mom!
Yeah, it's a compound fracture.
I'm sorry, sweetheart. You're gonna be okay.
Mom?
Well, you have a good set of crutches?
Seriously, Jake, what am I going to do with you?
Mom.
Hi, Jake.
Hi.
Ooh, she's really cute.
Mom.
Mom?
Not a chance. I left all that behind.
Mom.
Jake, sit up straight, honey.
Mom.
Mom?
Hi. You look so handsome. I'm so proud of you. You've got something on your face.
Mom.
Man, I almost get you teary-eyed, but we wanted to welcome all our moms here, and we want you to stand, and we want to give you a round of applause. All our moms, please stand today. If you're known as mom, if you nurture anybody, let's give them a round of applause. Thank you, moms. We got two special choirs, or two special numbers for you today, our preschool and our children. Let's go. Our Click kids are next. Come on, Click. All right. Scoot over there, girls. All right, spread out, girls. Come on down here. Yeah, there you go. All right.
You might have a mom. She might be the bomb, but ain't nobody got a mom like mine. Her love's till the end. She's my best friend. Ain't nobody got a mom like mine. She my world. She's my heart.
you already. Just writing songs, my mom's song.
Aw, I love you. Just want to unpack.
My heart hurts. I love you so much.
I love you more.
You might have a mom, she might be a bomb, but ain't nobody got a mom like mine. Her love till the end, she's my best friend. Ain't nobody got a mom like mine. You might have a mom, she might be a bomb, but ain't nobody got a mom like mine. Her love till the end, she's my best friend. Ain't nobody got a mom like mine. Oh, how she loves me to the moon and back. How she told me her love never ends. She's my best friend. Ain't nobody got a mom.
All right. Thank you, kids. Let's give them a round of applause. They did great. Let's give it to our moms, too. Couple of quick announcements, church family. Hey, VBS is fast approaching. Tiffany's needing help. And that's June 3rd through the 7th. June 3rd through the 7th. We've enlisted a lot of youth, but we need a lot of adults to come in, do kitchen, do different things, do sites. So please be available and be looking for opportunities to get involved with Vacation Bible School June 3rd through the 7th. Also, man, we have got a dinner. This is going to be a dinner, Sunday morning extravaganza or a big blowout, okay? We're going to honor Dwayne on the 26th of May, and we are going to have tables set out here like we do for Extreme Christmas and that different thing, okay? We are going to eat right after church, so you make sure you're here on the 26th. They got cards. They got a booth out there where you can write him a note and give him a love offering, that type of thing. It'll be out here. You just need to do it. Take the opportunity to be a blessing to him and Judy. And, man, we're going to thank him for 24 years of being here. So please make that on your list, okay? Also, man, let's pray for our worship service. And thank you again, moms. I mean, this is pretty awesome, but you are special. And all these kids, I can't help but smile every time they're up here. But there ain't a mom in here that ain't on your side. And I know that. Even my mom's back in Heron. She always tells me I do a good job. And, man, I never can't screw up too big where she won't claim me. So that's pretty good. So let's go to Lord in prayer. Tell me, Father, man, we're just here to worship you today. And we thank you for, man, giving us moms, giving us a mom that's always on our side. Tell me, Father, when the world seems to crush down on us, when we got things that are just blowing up, we can always count on mom's love. We can always count on mom being on our side. And tell me, Father, you planned it that way. And I just thank you for having a plan for these families and having us a special mom in each one of our lives that can do those things that nobody else can. And dear my Father, I just pray that you just be here as we worship you today. Be with Brother Dwayne as he delivers your word. Be with our song and worship team. Dear my Father, help us to honor you today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. I got one more thing. This guy always gets a short end of the stick. He turned 45 today. He's on our praise team. 41. Roth, happy birthday, Roth.
Stand and worship together this morning.
When all I see is a battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain. As I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. In every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is the cross, God, you see an empty tomb. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of Almighty Fortress. Almighty Fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows.
Silence here. To forget all of the great things you did. When did I throw away faith for the impossible? How did I start to believe that you weren't sufficient for me? Why do I talk myself out of seeing miracles? Oh, you are more than able. You are more than able.
Imagine with all of the faith in the room, what the Lord can do.
more than able. You are more than able. You are more than able. You are more than able. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Have the ushers come forward, please. You bow with me. Dear Lord, I just thank you for letting us gather in your house again today on this beautiful day. I just want to be with everybody here. A lot of the storms come through. Just hopefully everybody's okay and made it through that. And if not, just let them know that you will be with them through it all, Lord, and just carry them through it. Just be with everybody here today. I hope everybody's doing well. Happy Mother's Day to everybody. Just be with the offering. Just lay it on our hearts, Lord, to give what we need to give and where we need to give it. And just be with the pastors to bring the message. Let us hear it with open hearts and open ears. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. This is the great adventure. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. Hats off to the praise team. They did a great job. That last song is really good. Amen. It really is. Just remember this. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? And that's what we're going to talk about today. You know, when Josh was praying, he prayed kind of the same way in the first service as second. You know, we experienced these powerful storms. Day is done. Are we back now? All right, yeah. So we were watching these powerful storms. I'm going to write a blog on it. You know, I kind of have this bad habit of when the storm comes through, I, like, don't go to the basement. And so, yeah, I'm up there at the library entrance and TA's at the sanctuary entrance and watching this thing blow through. And it was amazing, the majesty of God. And just perhaps, maybe, in the storms is when we see the greatest majesty of God. So we want to talk about today about how do we deal with the storms of life. And the title says it all, really, 8:28, and I bet you can figure out that's Romans 8:28, and majestic mystery. How God can take the most difficult things in our lives and make them beautiful. You know, how many of y'all saw the Northern Lights this last couple days? Yeah, good. Hey, it's not too late if you have not. This is one of those things. It's not like the eclipse, but it's a really rare thing for the Northern Lights to make it down this far. And boy, they were just magnificent. And word on the street is that tonight there'll be one more time you'll be able to see the Northern Lights. you just have to go like way north to see this stuff. To see it this far south is really just an amazing thing. But here's what's crazy, and it really illustrates our title so well, is, you know, the northern lights are caused by this. So the sun has superpower gamma rays and all those scientific words, and they all explode in and go toward the earth. And they do it all the time. That's why you can see in the north. So all this energy, this cosmic energy, goes around the earth, the upper and lower poles, and it just makes all the energy and power makes the northern lights appear. And this was like a G5 effect. Last time they called one out was 24 years ago, and that's why we can see the northern lights here. But here's what's crazy. A storm so powerful we can't even imagine it on the sun caused all that energy cast this way to give us the northern lights. A storm, here it is, a storm can cause something beautiful. And I want you to understand in your life that sometimes the storms of life is where God shines the most in all his magnificent beauty. So let's look at our starting point, okay? Have you ever noticed this, that some Bible verses look great on a t-shirt and a coffee cup? And maybe in this room there's somebody who's got a shirt on, you know, and it's got one of your favorite Bible verses on it, and you know, it's maybe... How about now? Yeah, see, I've only got like three more shots at this, so I don't want to mess one up, you know? So anyway, yeah, where was I at in this conversation anyway? It's really strange. Oh, thank you. All right, yeah, so some verses look so great on a t-shirt or a coffee cup, and perhaps there's someone in this room, you've got Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, or maybe you got Jeremiah 29:11, the short version that says, you know, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to hurt you. Maybe you got John 3:16 somewhere on your shirt there, for God so loved the world, and that includes me, and all those are encouraging. But the problem is sometimes we leave them on the cup or we leave them on the t-shirt. And the power, oh, by the way, just for free, we do that with the Bible too. Too often we leave the Word of God within the flaps, and we got to get it off the pages and into our lives, and we got to get these powerful verses off our coffee cups and off our t-shirts and into our lives and into our hearts. And this pertains, you know, to Romans 8:28. One of the most wonderful verses in the Bible is Romans 8:28. But too often we can quote it, we put it on a shirt and a t-shirt, but we don't live it out. And the reason why this is so important we do not do that is because all of us go through storms. All of us. I was thinking, I wasn't going to share this, but I did in first service. I can tell this service is going to be different, you know, anyway. But, you know, my sisters, the Taylor ladies down south, you know, I've got one sister that this will be the first Mother's Day without her son. Remember, John died when he was 42 last June. So she's facing this Mother's Day without her son. And then I've got another sister whose husband is in progressive Parkinson's disease. And he's getting, you know, slowly worse and worse and worse. And then my third sister is the one diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. You know, hey, listen, guess what? Storms come. Anybody here in a storm? Yeah, anyone walking through the storm like we had this week? It seems like not a physical storm, but an emotional storm. You know, those things come. And Romans 8:28 gives us a new perspective, a powerful perspective. Let's look at the verse and see what it says. It says, you know, this is the new... You know, normally when there must be a dead spot up here, Jamal. You know, normally, you know, when I quote Romans 8:28, and it's pretty accurate. I mean, you know, all things work. You know, I said, you do know, don't you? I'm talking to someone, you know, and they're in a difficult situation, and I say, well, you do know, just like Paul said, and you do know that all things work together for good to those who love God, who are the called according to his purpose. But what I love about the New Living, it makes something so crystal clear that you really need to grasp. Look what it says. And we know, got that part, and we know that God calls us everything to work together. I like that. God causes everything to work together. So when these storms roll through our life, when life gets hard, our marriages are in trouble, our kids are going down this path, or your parents are going down this path, however it might be, you've got this assurance, this promise that God, you know, is causing, he's causing all things to work together for good, for good. So God is on your side. God is on your side, and he has this wonderful, miraculous, majestic power to take the worst situation and work it for good. And he causes it. He causes it. If without God, your tragedies remain just a simple tragedy. Your disasters remain disasters. Your tsunamis remain tsunamis without God. But you put God in the equation, and he comes along and causes this thing to work together for good. For good. That doesn't mean God makes everything good. We all know that. I've preached that. But what it does mean is God can bring good out of the worst situation. Now, you got to. Remember the three words there, and we know? Do you know that? No. Do you really know that? Do you know in the midst of your heartache and your heartbreak, do you know that God can take this horrible situation that simply is just simply living in an imperfect, you know, messed up world, which is that way from Adam and Eve. You know, do you know that he really can work it for the good of those who love God? And that's the key right there. The key is only those who truly love God can see that he's working for the good. The more we love God, the easier it is to see through the lens of him working everything for our good. It's just part of the deal. And then he does this for those who are called according to his purpose for them. God has a plan he's working out in your life. And your plan won't work like, you know, won't look like my plan. You know, your plan may not look like your husband's plan. Okay? But God's plan is always best and always works. So the big news today is this majestic mystery is no matter what your situation is right now, and I mean it could be a humdinger, okay, that you need to have the assurance that as a Christ follower, a Christ believer, okay, you have the confident assurance that God is going to cause those circumstances to be good in your life. And that's not Dwayne Taylor's deal. That's God's deal. And whenever God makes a deal, he always pulls it off. Amen? Now, Jerry Bridges is a great Bible teacher, and he decided to expound on this, and it's a really long quote. I'm not sure how big it is on the words up there, but look at this. He says, you know, to derive the fullest comfort and encouragement from Romans 8:28. In other words, to get the maximum benefit from Romans 8:28, we must come to the conclusion that God is working in a proactive and not reactive way. Proactive means he is active and he's causing good. He's causing the good come. And not reactive, you know, like he's not like, oh no, there's a fire in Dwayne's life, let's run and put the fire out. And then there's a fire over here in Judy's life, let's run and put that fire. That is not how God works. God is so massive in our lives that he is going to be proactive. He has the ability, not just around putting fires out, but he can cause it. He works to make it good in our lives. Let's read on further. God doesn't just respond to adversity in our lives to make the best of a bad situation. Don't we? Isn't that how we perceive it? Well, I'm going through this bad things, okay, and God just makes it more palatable, you know. In my personal opinion, sugar makes everything better. You could put sugar on turnips. It makes it just a little bit better, all right? That's how we see it. But look what he says. No. Jerry says, no. He knows before he initiates or permits the adversity. Wait, Dwayne. Did you just say God initiates adversity? Sure does. He sure does. Because you see, he sees adversity as an opportunity for us to grow as Jesus people, okay? In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, I think it's verse number 9 or 7, you know, Paul is sitting there, and Paul had this grandiose vision. Many people believe he was, like, caught up to heaven and actually saw heaven and came back. And so God was kind of like a little concerned that maybe Paul would get a little bit prideful about that. And so Paul said, well, because of that, God sent a thorn in my flesh. There was some kind of physical ailment. We don't know what it was, but what we do know is it came from God. God put it into his life for the specific reason of being not prideful, to help him not be prideful. So yeah, sometimes he initiates, and sometimes he permits. You ever heard of a guy named Job? Gosh, what a mess that life was, or at least our perspective, okay? But God permitted that to come into his life for a specific reason. So he knows before he initiates and permits adversity exactly how he will use it. How he will what? Use it. How he will use it for our good and his glory. Anything, listen. Anything God brings into your life, you can trust one thing. He'll use it. If there's suffering in your life right now, God does not waste suffering. If there's suffering in your life right now, they're suffering for a reason. And God will not waste your suffering. God will not waste your suffering. He will use it for our good and for his glory. So what does Acts got to say about all of this? Well, here's the deal. We're going to pick it up in Acts chapter 11, verse number 19. And what's happened is, a couple chapters back, they elected some deacons, okay? And after they elected the deacons, and they were going to, like, you know, wait on tables and stuff and help serve and minister to the widows, wasn't too long after that. Well, you know, the Bible says Stephen was a great guy. He was filled with the Spirit. And so he started preaching, and he preached to the wrong people, the wrong crowd, and they got really mad. And these are the same guys, by the way, who crucified Jesus. And so they got really mad, and they stoned him to death. Okay, that boy, you're talking about adversity, that's terrible. And so, yeah, so what happens is God used that stoning of Stephen, okay, to cause the church to scatter. All right, now here's the deal. Why was that so important? Why was it important that the church scatter? And the reason why is because of Acts 1:8. Jesus said, and you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. So here's an adverse situation. Stephen dies, and God uses it, a Romans 8:28 minute, and uses it to scatter the church. To scatter the church. Let's read it. Meanwhile, the believers who had been scattered, so they're on the run. Band on the run. Band on the run. Okay. So the believers who had been scattered during the persecution after Stephen's death traveled. So what's happening? What's happening? This was an adverse situation, okay? But now the gospel's going just like Jesus said had to. They wouldn't have left Jerusalem had it not been for the persecution, and the persecution came. Matter of fact, the Bible says as soon as Stephen died, was killed, man, there was a tsunami. That very day, there was a tsunami of persecution. So, man, the church is on the run, but look what happens. They travel as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch of Syria. They preach the word. There it is. That's 8:28. What is the good that came out of Stephen's death? The persecution. And what was the good that came out of the persecution? The preaching of the word. God's purpose was that the word of God be spread, and he used that for it to happen. They preached the word, but notice that he only did it to the Jews. We'll talk about that in just a moment. So let's look at our teaching point. So Stephen was the first martyr of the young church, but he wouldn't be the last. So here's a guy. Now, by the way, stop. Whoa. Here's a guy who loved Jesus a lot. And they kill him. So our thought would be, boy, where was God on that one? In Florida? You know, have you ever asked that question? Cancer comes, broken marriage, unfaithfulness. And where was God? God, where were you? Okay. God was on the throne. And God was working. God was working. So he was the first martyr of the young church, and then a tsunami, literally a tsunami of persecution broke out in Jerusalem against the people of the way. Now, like a busted covey of quail. Now, I had to throw that in for Kerry Jones. He's a big bird hunter. Anybody here hunt birds? Yeah. You hunt birds, really? Are y'all kidding me? I don't know if you hunt birds. Well, anyway, we don't have any quail in Southern Illinois anymore, but we used to have. okay? And I used to go quail hunting with a friend of mine back in Missouri. And he had this great bird dog. And I won't get it totally right, so you don't need to correct me if I get it wrong. But we would go out in the woods, you know, out in this field, and we would go, and the bird dog would be out in front of us, and he would go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And he was looking for the birds. And so all of a sudden he would go on point, and it went something like this. Like that. Okay? Yeah. So he was on point. And boy, he would just sit there and quiver. Just quiver. He wanted so bad. But he knew, okay, he was to point and stay put. All right, so we would finally catch up with him, and we sitting there. And if I remember correctly, the dog owner, Bill in this case was his name, would say, okay. And the bird dog would instantly start moving in. And what's he doing? He's going to flush the quail. He's going to flush the quail. He's going to bust the covey. So as soon as the bird dog got in there, the bird's flushed, and what happens? We shoot the birds, okay? But that could only happen when the covey was busted, all right? Listen, the gospel would not spread until God busted the covey. And I'm telling you, God wants to do it again. If the church is going to be the church, we've got to be the church outside these four walls. We have got to get out those doors, and we have got to be Jesus. We got to be the church on the streets of Harrisburg and where else God sends us. It's just so very, very important. So like a busted covey of quail, they scattered. And brothers and sisters, we need to scatter for the purpose of the gospel. But listen, it wasn't random. It wasn't random. Strategic. Because God had a plan. Now I'm telling you, these are challenging times for our church and for me. As I go into our next chapter, as y'all go in your next chapter, I want you to know something. You know, it's strategic. It's not random. The more I thought about this, the more I just know this is God's plan for us and for you. And you know what? It's not random. God has a plan. He has a plan for the Taylors. And guess what? He has a plan for Dorisville. And boy, it's exciting. I can't wait to see. Because Lord willing, I'm going to be around to see what all he does. And I can't wait to see what he's got for us together, okay? And me individually at whatever ministry God puts me in, but together, because we'll be here to share this together. I think it's going to be an amazing, amazing, wonderful thing, all right? So, in verse number 20, the story gets bigger. Somebody say bigger. Bigger. Yeah. All right, so we got the people out there, and they're being good Jews, okay? Not very good Christians, but being good Jews. And so they go out and they start telling people about Jesus. They preach the word of God. But they only preached it to the Jews. And do you remember what Jesus said? You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. Remember what Peter said in Acts chapter 2? This promise is for you and your children and those afar off. So the gospel had to go further than just the Jews. Well, here it comes. In verse number 20, however, some of the believers, somebody say some of the believers. Yeah, see, some of the believers got a little excited. Some of the believers decided to think out of the box. Some of the believers refused to be bound to the idea that the gospel was just for the Jews, because it wasn't. Some of them remembered the words of Peter on Pentecost. Some of them believed the commission of Jesus to go to the uttermost part, because some of the believers who went to Antioch from Cyprus and Cyrene began preaching to the Gentiles. Yeah, my wife gets it. I mean, listen, you got to be excited about that, because that's why we're here. Because people like this, and Paul in particular, took the gospel beyond the immediate to the far off. So they thought outside the box. They started preaching the Gentiles about the Lord Jesus. Now, here's what I want to challenge you to do. I want to challenge you as a church, more than ever, to think outside the box. I want to challenge you to be a Gentile preaching church. You know, there are people out there, listen guys, there are people out there who desperately need the gospel, and they don't look like you, and they don't talk like you, and they don't dress like you, and they don't think like you, and they got piercings and tattoos. Some of them are having sexual identity, gender issues, man, and they're going to come one day. They're going to come. Either you're going to bump into them on the street, or they're going to come in this door one day, and we've got to be ready to share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ with them. We've got to think outside the box. Why, Dwayne? Oh, tell me why, Dwayne? Because Jesus did. Jesus did. So this is a great opportunity for us more than ever to think outside the box and preach to those Gentiles, to be ready when they walk through the door, to be ready to do that. So what's our teaching point? Unlikely fields often yield an unlikely harvest. I said this in first service, and I'm not really sure they got it, and I'm not sure I got it, but for some reason it makes sense. You know, I'm older. Thank you for being kind. I'm older, and I'm from that generation. So in the 50s and early 60s, you know, everybody was a Christian. Did you know that? I mean, you know, we were a Christian nation. Okay, we thought we were a Christian nation. But you could go anywhere. You could go to the mall. You could go to the gas station. You could go to school, students. You could go anywhere. Oh, I'm a Christian. Everybody's a Christian. I'm a Christian. In fact, a lot of people, you know, went to church. I mean, they would, you know, get drunk on Saturday and go to church on Sunday. They'd beat their wife on Saturday and, you know, get up and go to church on Sunday. You know, Bubba was an alcoholic and drunk, and yet he was still a deacon at the church. That was the way it was. You went on the streets and nobody would even own up. If they were lost, they wouldn't own it. But you know what? Unlikely fields yield unlikely times, because guess what? Now we know. You know what we know? We know America is not a Christian nation. America is a post-Christian nation. And what does that mean? That means the fields are riper than ever for harvest. The fields are riper than ever to harvest. There are people out there now, and they're not putting on a false label saying, I'm a Christian. They're saying, let me tell you something, I'm not a Christian. And you can say, well, guess what? I want to tell you about how you can be. Come on, amen? Amen. Isn't that great? I mean, the fields are ripe for harvest. Unlikely fields often yield unlikely harvest. Don't be afraid to go where others fear to tread. We got to be just like Jesus. Jesus would go intentionally to Samaria. Jesus meant to go this, because like I say, the word on the street is this from Christian leaders, that this the big news, as you know, the big talk on the street is, you know, gender identity and all that mess. That's going to fall apart. That's going to fall apart. And when it does, they're going to look for some answers. And they just might walk through our doors. And we got to be ready. We got to love them like Jesus would. We got to speak truth to them. No compromise. We got to speak truth, but we got to love them with that truth. That's what we got to be. And I pray that this will be the kind of church that's willing to do this, kind that's willing to think outside of the box. Verse number 21. So here's what happens. The power of the Lord was with them. These ones that thought outside the box, these ones who went to the Gentiles, God says, oh, I'm going to pour my power. Listen, if you want the power of God on your church, you got to be willing to think outside the box. You got to be a gospel preaching, gospel sharing church. You got to be willing to pray for and love the ones that desperately need Jesus Christ. The power of the Lord was upon them, was with them. And what happened? Somebody say large number. A large number of these Gentiles believed, and they turned to the Lord. The field was ripe. You remember a while back, I said, 2 weeks ago, I said, you know, the same fields that are ripe for judgment are ripe for harvest. That's America. Never before have more people admitted to being lost. And you know, what's the first step in being saved? Knowing you're lost. Knowing you're lost. I'm telling you, there's a harvest that's waiting before us that's amazing. So, what's our teaching point? This is really good. I wrote down in my little note thing, I put, this is for us. This is for us. Here he is. You know, new by default means different, and I'm going to amend it just a moment. New by default means different, and different can be difficult. You know, the next chapter for us is new. And that means it's going to be difficult, maybe. It's going to be different. You know, as we progress together and separately, okay, it's going to be different. And we got to be willing to own that difference and own that difficulty. You know, it's easier to say, to look for the no than embrace the yes. No. Why? Because we've never done it that way. No, No. You know, Gia was reading, Gia reads to me some stuff. She researches a lot. And let me ask you a question. If somebody was to propose a new idea to you, what's the first thing out of your mouth? Is it no or yes? In a generally Baptist, did you know the average Baptist can't spell change? No, seriously. I'm serious. We can't. Okay? Yeah, so if somebody proposes a new idea to you, you know, because there might be some new ideas in the future, right? We got to be ready for it, okay? So they propose a new idea to you, is your first thought why we can't do that or why we can do that? That's what I'm talking about here. You know, it's easier to look for the no than embrace the yes. Change should include ownership and disregard blame. If somebody goes, listen, don't blame anybody. Just be willing to embrace change if God brings change, and be willing to be a part of that if it'll reach more people for Lord Jesus Christ. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? It's really uncomfortable for folks. It's uncomfortable for me. I don't like change. I'm a creature of routine. Guess what I had for breakfast yesterday? Yeah, egg beaters, Laughing Cow, light cheese, and some kind of meat, either bacon bits or sausage. Guess what I had a week ago for breakfast? Yeah, Laughing Cow, cheese with egg beaters and some kind of meat. I sort of do. I'm a creature of habit. But if we stay in the habit, we might miss the great opportunities that God has for us. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? So we got to be ready and willing to change. Look at verse number 22. Well, the church back in Jerusalem, first off, they got this word. You know, they found out that Peter had gone to the Gentiles, okay, and told them about Jesus because he, you know, God told him to, and he went, and they received the Holy Spirit. So they were dealing with that, and now all of a sudden, when the church at Jerusalem heard what had happened about the Gentiles, they sent Barnabas to Antioch. Oh, this is big. All right, so they sent this guy named Barnabas to Antioch to see what was going on, So when he arrived, he saw this evidence of God's blessing. Now, see the word saw? See the word evidence? See the words God blessings? Okay, so when he shows up, it was obvious to Barnabas that God was working. Why? He looked for the eyes of God. As you enter this next chapter for you, and we are a new chapter for us, and we are a new chapter together, okay, we've got to look through the eyes of God. We've got to look through the eyes of God's love and God's wisdom. So when he arrived and saw this evidence of God's blessings, he was filled with joy. This is probably the last time you're going to hear this from me as your pastor. When I come back and preach later on, you may hear it again then. But remember what biblical joy is? Biblical joy is a deep sense of well-being based on my faith in God and trust in his sovereign will. Okay? So he was filled with that trust and the joy and encourage. He encouraged the believers to stand true to the word. Now, what didn't he do? Watch this. What didn't he do? He didn't go, y'all can't do this. What do y'all mean dancing around in church? What do you mean playing them drums? What do you mean? You know what he did? He encouraged them. He didn't bind them up. He set them free. Church, don't bind people. Set them free. Now, within the scope of God's word, don't think I've gone nuts the last three messages. I'm just telling you, as we face this great opportunity that God has us for these next chapters in our lives, man, we don't want to miss a single opportunity. You know, I love what Andy Stanley said one time. He said, listen, people are going to get offended, but, you know, don't you offend them. Let the gospel offend them. If they're going to be offended, let the gospel offend them. And, you know, again, it's hard. You know, it's hard to walk into a brand new building. If you look different, taste different, smell different, dress different, whatever it is. Embrace them and welcome them into our fellowship. That's what Barnabas did. And he was filled with joy. He encouraged the believers to stay true to the word. We need to encourage those to stay true to the word, okay? All right, I'm totally lost where I am. All right, let's look at our teaching point. We all should strive to be a Barnabas. Now, I'm gonna do two things. I'm gonna tell us how we ought to be, and I'm gonna tell you what your new pastor ought to be. So I was waiting for somebody to go, that's just none of your business. You want to bet? I got 24 years invested in this family. It is more of my business. And besides that, I'm still a member here. All right? So here we go. All right, so we all should strive to be a Barnabas, also known as the son of encouragement. So we should be a church of encouragement. A church of encouragement. After all, the world and the church already has more than enough cynics and critics. So again, we should be encouraging to one another. Encouraging to one another. All right, now, I'm going to tell you what kind of preacher you should get, but I'm also going to tell you again what kind of Christian you should be, because it's one and the same. Look at verse number 24. This is a great verse. Barnabas, also known as son of encouragement, was a good man. The first thing you want to look for in a pastor, you want a good man. That's a good place for an amen. You don't want a bad man, do you? You don't want just a charismatic guy. You a man who loves God. That's what you want, a good man. And beside that, oh, by the way, boy, Judy, I can't believe I'm telling y'all this. But you can't fire me because I'm really already gone. Listen. The steps of what kind of man? The steps of a righteous man, are ordered by the Lord. That's why you want a good man. You want a man whose steps are ordered by the Lord, okay? And by the way, what kind of Christian should you be? Same kind. You're a good man, woman, too, because, again, of what Jesus did for you. So Barnabas was a good man. He was full of the Holy Spirit. You want somebody full of the Holy Spirit. To be filled with the Spirit means to be under total control of the Holy Spirit. You want a pastor who is filled and controlled with the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. All right, and look at this. And strong in faith. You want a pastor who's not afraid to step outside the box. You want a pastor who really has faith. We sang about that faith today. And that's the kind of man y'all need, we need as a pastor, okay? So we want him to be a good man, full of the Holy Spirit, and strong in faith. And when that happens, many people were brought back to the Lord. We need to be a church like that, a good man, full of Holy Spirit, and strong in faith. We need to find a pastor the same way, and people will be brought back to the Lord. We have got to be so unusual in our outreach, our ministry, that people are drawn to our church. Not because of our band, and boy, we got a good one. Not because of a charismatic speaker that will keep you from going to sleep for 30 minutes, but because of the Holy Spirit moving and swinging in our midst. Does that make sense? See how exciting this is? I mean, this is really an exciting, exciting time, all right? So there's a quote by C.S. Lewis, and here's the good news. You know, God often uses circumstances and hardships to prepare ordinary people for an extraordinary destiny. Now, look at me. I said this to you in different words. The best days of Doorsville are in the future. Say amen. Say amen and believe it. The best days of Doorsville. Listen, we have this extraordinary destiny before us. And I just can't wait to see how God's going to play all that out. Well, Barnabas apparently knew he needed a little bit of help. So he went and got somebody. All right, look at Acts 11:25. And by the way, if you could combine two men, you're talking about the perfect pastor, you know, someone who of faith, filled with the Holy Spirit, a good man, and then you got this guy we're fixing to talk about, you know, and what a Bible extraordinaire. I mean, wow, what a combination. Well, verse 25, so Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. Who's Saul? This is Saul, and he's not Paul yet, he's Saul. So this is pretty soon after his conversion. Now, why would Barnabas go and find a new guy like Saul to help him in Antioch? Because Barnabas was the son of encouragement. He said, that young preacher boy might just need some encouragement. So he goes to Tarsus and gets Saul, looks for him. When he found him, he brought him back to Antioch. Isn't that cool? You know, that Barnabas brought a man alongside and said, hey, look, you know, I'm going to give you some practical experience here on how to be a preacher teacher, okay? So both of them stayed there with the church for a full year, teaching large crowds of people. And you know what? It's really cool. And for the very first time at Antioch, amidst all of this great stuff that's going on, amidst all of that, the Bible says, and for the first time, they were called Christians. Amen. Isn't that cool? You know, I still like the term disciple. I like the term Christ follower. Because you know, if you've been in America more than, you know, 5 minutes, you know, even now today, it's Christian's so generic. You know, have you ever, no, but I go to church. I got religion. I got some good habits. I quit drinking. I must be a Christian. Okay? But that's what I like about Christ follower and disciple. But in his purest form, it was that Antioch believers were first called Christians. It means Christ-like. Christian means Christ-like. As we go forward in our journey, we need to be Christ-like. And when you're facing these storms, 828 storms in your life, how did Jesus face the cross? With faith. How did he face, you know, the Sanhedrin? By faith. How do we face our storms? By faith. How do we just trust God? We do it by faith. Simply by faith. So as we launch into this new future, this new future we have, if you're in a storm right now, just know this, that God is with you. And he will never leave you, and he will never forsake you. And if you're ever persecuted for your faith, and students, this could happen. They're high school, middle school, it could happen. Just remember this, he will not leave you, he will not forsake you. And then, as we trust God for the future, and it involves change, it'll be different, and all of that, we can trust him. Because guess what? He's got this. Amen? He's got this. Let's pray. Hey, God, thank you for the privilege of allowing me to share today, and thank you for the freedom and liberty to do so. And I want to pray, Father, for the one who's in a storm right now. I pray you'll give them your peace, a peace that passes all understanding. I pray for that. And, Father, I want to keep praying and ask you for, as we look at the future of our church, I want to pray, Father, that we will keep trusting you. Father, anchor our faith in you. Anchor our faith in you. Father, help us to be encouragers. Help us to be filled under control of the Holy Spirit. Help us to be willing to think outside the box. Father, help us to even go where some churches just won't go. Loving people because you love them. Help us, Lord. We need your faith, and we're going to trust you for it. Thanks, God, for the privilege of speaking today. And Jesus, I pray it in your precious name. Amen. Our friend Brent is here, and the altar's open today. If you'd like to come and pray, the altar's open for that. If there's a decision you want to make, Brother Brent can help you with that. Whatever we can do to help you, to do whatever you need to do with what you heard today, we want to do that. Let's stand to our feet.
Blessed assurance, and Jesus is mine, and he's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time, and born of his Spirit, and washed in his blood. What he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. And I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I know the odds. my story. This is my song, praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. I trust in God, my Savior.
So very good. Hey, thank you so much for coming today. Brent, you got anything to talk about? The search committee? All right, we can do that. Can I lead that? Would that be okay? All right, good
don't
deal.
Tonight.
Thank you. Nothing here at Doorsville tonight. All services are canceled because of Mother's Day. Spend the day with your family. That's so important. Is God good? Amen. He really is, guys. Come on. Amen. Come on. Yeah. And I want you to know that's especially important if you're in a storm right now. I just want to reassure you, as your pastor and your friend, that God is good. That's God, and He's with you. He will not leave you, and He will not forsake you, no matter what. No matter what. Well, let's bow our heads. I'll dismiss us, and also we'll pray for the search committee at the same time. Well, God, You are so good today. I thank You for incredible worship. I thank You for these words of these songs. I trust in God. That's what we need to do, Father. As we, as a church, look to the future, Father, help us to trust You no matter what. And we want to thank You, Father, for our search committee. Father, on their shoulders is a hard and large task. But with Philippians 4:13 on our mouths, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. I pray for extreme wisdom for them. I pray for discernment. I pray for insight, Father. And then I pray for a congregation that will pray for them and support them and encourage them. It really is exciting as we think about, you know, what the next steps are. We're grateful for that. So we look forward to seeing what You're going to do in Doorsville Baptist Church and the congregation, Father, the church family. So we are so appreciative. Now, Lord, as we spend some time this afternoon with our families, help us to enjoy that. Let's be sure, Father, to be thankful for ones who have so gratefully poured into our lives. We're thankful for that. So we certainly love You. We love these dear folks. Pray Your blessings on their lives. And Jesus, I pray in Your precious name. Amen. God bless you guys.